And ask you a question. And I think both of these questions are going to be fairly yes for most of us. Have you ever been bullied in your life? Whether a childhood, maybe a teenager, maybe it's adult. You ever been bullied? I think it's hard to believe at some point, verbally, physically, that some of us were in it some way. In fact, I was trying to think of time in my life, and I think of some of the stuff I did as a kid, and I can't believe I don't remember more times that I was bullied. But I do remember this one time in fifth grade where I was being picked on by a kid that sadly was about the same size as me. I don't know what was going on with this, but what I remember is he said, I'd had enough, and I was pushing back. He said, "You want to fight?" And I guess I said yes, because at recess, we're outside, and I'm getting right, I've never had a fight before. And I don't know if I, like right now, I love watching thrillers. I've seen all the fight moves. Back then, I had a feeling, I still remember telling myself, wait for him to punch, duck, and then get him. That was my plan. Well, it sounds much better than what it is, because he went to punch and I ducked. My plan wasn't to see where the punch is coming from. My plan was just to duck. I ducked as he was coming up. I ducked and my nose got in the way of his fist. One punch and my nose is bloody all over the place. And that was it. That was the end of the fight. Now, in the junior high and high school, we actually became friends. And I don't remember what got that started. That was not a wise move. But let me ask you this. Have you ever bullied somebody else? Have you ever been that person, whether it's physical, maybe it's verbal? And I sadly could think of several times like that. There was a kid in middle school. His name was Byron Bailey. And he was a bigger kid, and he was a kid that talked slow. He probably had some mental disabilities, and it was just people had a nickname. And I don't know, just because it rhymed, I guess. It was buy one Bailey, get one free. That's just what they called him. And I would get involved in that, and I would tease him along with everybody else. And looking back now, it just makes me sick that I took pleasure in that. Why is it things like that, that so many of us, when we're around friends or other people who are doing the bullying, the picking on, it seems like, oh, we're better, we can do that, and it's easy to laugh at, not even thinking of what it's like being that person who's being picked on. So we're starting a new series tonight, a four-week series on things that I think kids, as well as adults, it's not just a teen issue, have gone through. And the first thing we're looking at tonight is bullying. And next week, we'll get into some other things. So I've got my school props up here to give us an idea of where I think a lot of this starts is back in school. And I think when I think of bullying, you think of the underdog, because we have pleasant thoughts of the underdog, the kid who's getting picked on that comes and fights back and gets revenge, right? Those are the good stories that we think of. And the first thing I think of is this video clip I want to share. I think you all recognize this. So if you know this movie, The Christmas Story, I watch it every single year. I think I'm the only one in my family that still really enjoys this movie. I should think partially because I was the kid back in school that stuck my tongue in the pole for real life, and it got stuck. But this is a time that we look at that bully and think, he finally got what was due, right? The kid had snapped. Now, we know if you watch the movie that he gets his mouth washed out with soap later on, but that seems like a really good thing. He got his revenge. But is that what God has planned for us? Is that the best for us? You know, once there was a truck driver who went in to have a meal, and not soon after he'd gotten his meal, a motorcycle gang had stopped by. And they all come in, and they started picking on him, acted like a bully. They took salt and pepper and poured it all over him. They took his meal away, and finally he just didn't say a word. He just got up, he went and paid his bill, and walked out of the restaurant. The leader of the gang looked at the waitress. The waitress had come over, and they said, "Man, that guy wasn't much of a fighter, was he?" And she said, "No." But as she looked out in the night, she goes, "I guess he's not much of a driver either, because he just ran over three of your motorcycles." And we look at these stories and think, yeah, we want to get even. It's not right. It's not fair that people pick on people that they feel like they can overwhelm. According to the American Medical Association, by the time students finish school, nearly half of the students have been bullied at one point or another, and it's a serious issue that needs to be addressed. So let's look at what bullying is. You know, people usually know what bullying is when they see it, but it's sometimes hard to put into words. Researchers who study bullying cite three common characteristics of what it takes to be in the act of bullying. Number one, bullying is intentional and tries to cause harm or distress to another person. Number two, bullying occurs between two students have different degrees of power. And number three, bullying repeatedly happens over time. Sadly, some of us have been through this. But there's also three types of bullying that can occur. Number one, the most common I think of is the physical, right? We think of the physical, we think of hitting and kicking and spitting, tripping, pushing, breaking somebody's things, rude gestures. Now this makes me think of the old saying that we've heard for years, right? Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. That's the stupidest saying ever, because we know that words are oftentimes more hurtful, more damaging than somebody physically hurting us ever could be, which is number two, verbal bullying, which is teasing, name-calling, threats, inappropriate sexual comments, taunting. But then there's a third that we sometimes don't think about, social. That's leaving someone out of a group on purpose, telling others not to be friends with them, publicly embarrassing them, spreading gossip or rumors about somebody else, and etc. In fact, with the increase of computers and cell phones, especially among teenagers and young adults, there's also another type of bullying that I'm sure you've heard of called cyberbullying. And this is bullying which harassment is done electronically over technology like texting and emails and social media and things like that. Sadly, this is so damaging. Now, I can't remember. I'm 50, and when I was a kid, we didn't have cell phones. We didn't have technology. We didn't have social media to spread this. I can't imagine what it would have been like to go through this. But some of you know what it's like. You've had friends. You've had kids maybe go through this. It's got to be terrifying because you get 10 times the amount of bullying that can be done because it spreads so fast. It can get out there so quickly. And sadly, this is what often causes so many suicides in kids because they get to a point where they just don't think they can live, where they can take it anymore. That's how damaging this can be. So we're going to look at three parts of Scripture that talks about bullying and what God expects from us. The first one is going to come from Romans chapter 12, verses 14 through 21. And here the Apostle Paul is writing to the churches in Rome, and he's giving them guidelines. And he says, bless those who persecute you. Bless, don't curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. He goes, do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. And if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals over his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Now, we can look at this and say, yeah, that's nice to say, but that seems impossible. How do you treat somebody who's really rude, mean, and just spiteful to you? How do you give them more? How do you treat them fairly and treat them extra nice like you would a loved family member? Well, let's look at another scripture that really short, just one verse here, that the Apostle Paul was talking to his mentee Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:7, where he says, For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but it gives us power and love and self-discipline. So I wanted to look at what the commentary of David Guzik had to say about this and really break this down and what it means in our lives. You see, Paul saw that Timothy was timid in his ways. Timothy knew the fear that he sometimes felt. God wanted Timothy to know that this fear wasn't from the God that he served. You see, we all face situations where we feel timid and afraid. For some, speaking in front of others makes them fear. Others are afraid of confrontation. Others are being made to look foolish. Others are afraid of rejection. We all deal with fear. And I can say there's probably nobody in this room, myself included, that doesn't have fear of one thing or another. The first step in dealing with such fears is to understand that they are not from God. These fears do not come from God. It's a significant step to say, this isn't God making me feel like this. God hasn't given me this. The second step in dealing with such fears is understanding what God has given us to overcome this. He's given us his Spirit of power and love and discipline. self-discipline. You see, God has given us a spirit of power. You see, when we do His work, proclaim His word, and represent His kingdom, we have His power supporting us. We are safe in the hands of God. God has given us a spirit of love. This tells us a lot about the power He's given us. Many think of power in terms of how much we can control others, right? That's what we think of power, being strong. But Jesus' power is expressed in how much we can love and serve others. On the night before the cross, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into His hands, what did Jesus do with all that power that God has given Him? He knew what was coming. He knew what was at stake, and He could do whatever He wanted. He humbly washed the feet of His disciples to show the example of what God expects for us. God has given us self-discipline. The ancient Greek word here is the idea of being calm and self-controlled mind, in contrast to the panic and confusion that rushes in when we're in a fearful situation. You see, Paul wrote this to Timothy because boldness matters. Without it, we can't fulfill God's purpose for our lives. God's purpose is for more than making money, more than being entertained and being comfortable. It is for each of us to make good use of the gift that He has given us to touch the people that are in this needy world. The last scripture I want to look at is from the words of Jesus Himself. Here again, when we have doubts, when we have questions of what we are to do, what God wants us to do, look at the example of Jesus, His Son. And we're taking this from Matthew 5, and this is Matthew 5, verse 43. And this is during the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' most famous, longest sermon recorded. And Matthew, the disciple, records what he wrote down. He goes, "You've heard it said to love your neighbor and hate your enemy." You see, these Jewish people would have grown up with the time of knowing the commandment from God to love your neighbors. But they took it in turn, and some of the Pharisees would push us out there. That means you love your neighbors, but you hate your enemies. But Jesus said, "I tell you to love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. You may be so that you may be children of your Father who's in heaven. He causes His Son to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing this?" And what he's talking about, the tax collectors were looked at as the worst at the time, because these were Jewish people working for the hated Romans and cheating on top of that, cheating their own Jewish people. And even the tax collectors could love who they loved. It's easy to love people who love you back, right? That's human nature. But he says, if you only greet your own people, what are you doing more than the others? Do not even the pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Now, once again, we need to understand God doesn't expect us to be perfect. Nobody is perfect here on earth. Only God is perfect. But we have the example of Jesus. And when we live our lives and follow Jesus, we become perfect in God's eyes. We need to be like Jesus. So I wanted to look at some practical steps that we could do to overcome bullying, and when we see bullying around in our lives, in our families' lives. I saw an article from Neil Hayden from Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission just a few years ago. It says, "What does the Bible teach us about bullying?" And there's four steps. Number one, if you see something, say something. Reporting bullying to the proper authorities is one of the most important strategies that we can use to prevent further bullying. 28% of students ages 6 through 12, grade 6 through 12, that have been bullied at school, yet only 20 to 30% of those who are bullied actually report it when they are bullied. You see, as Christians, we are called to seek justice and defend the oppressed, as told to us in Psalms and Isaiah. You see, something extremely important to remember is that it is not tattling to report bullying. Tattletales only tell on someone when they want to get them in trouble. Reporting bullying protects you, the person being bullied, and everyone else around you. Doing nothing helps bullies because it allows them to continue to bully others without consequences. We need to have courage and stand up for those who can't or who won't defend themselves. So number one, if you see something, say something. Number two, understand who you are in Christ. Meditate on passages like Psalm 139, 13 through 18, which tells us that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. and that God's thoughts towards you are too numerous to count. You need to know that you are special to God and created in His image with immeasurable worth and value. Don't let that lies that the bullies tell you influence you what you think about yourself. Because what God says about you is the truth. He loves you and He cherishes you because you are made in His image. Number three, even if you're wronged, respond in a Christ-like manner. Now this is tough. I will say this is the toughest one, especially in the heat of the moment. He goes, when we are in the midst of a painful situation, it can be very easy to forget who we are in Christ and how He has called us to act. Thus, if you ever find yourself being bullied, there are a couple of principles that you need to keep in mind. First of all, you should never try to get back at a bully or seek revenge, as told to us in Romans 12. As Christians, we know that this world that we're around is not perfect. But we are not the judge of the earth. God is the only one who can judge the world in righteousness and repay everyone for the evil that they have done. Instead, respond to your bully with kindness and love. Yes, I said that right. Respond to your bully with kindness and love. I know this is easier said than done. It's easy to feel angry, upset, or defeated about your situation. Bringing in those feelings of temptation to want to get back at them. We want revenge at them. But what Scripture and the Bible tells us to do is to love our enemies and pray for them. Do not try and overcome evil by being done to you by doing evil in return. Rather, overwhelm your opponents with the goodness and the love of God. You never know how your kindness may change your heart or may change their heart. And this makes me think, I know this is extremely difficult. I can tell you, if somebody's picking on me, whether it's physical or verbal or whatever, I'm going to want to fight back. I'm going to want to protect myself. And that's extremely difficult. How do you love them? How do you be kind to them? Right there in that situation. One of my favorite three words that's in the Scripture is told all 9 times in the New Testament. Make every effort. This is what I strongly, firmly believe that God wants for us, is to make every effort in following Him. That means in situations like this, when we're asked to love others who are not treating us well, who are being mean, disrespectful, rude, you name it, we are to love them in the midst of that, or make every effort to do that. Know that God also loves those bullies. He loves those people who are picking on you as much as He does anybody else. They're all made in His image. And sometimes, if we're loving back to them, we act in a way that they would never expect, that could bring them to God that no other way may have never had a chance to do that. And he goes, secondly, it's okay to stick up for yourself if you're bullied. Jesus Himself, when He was slapped unjustly, didn't just turn the other cheek, but questioned His accusers, as told in John 18:22. From other passages of Scripture, like Exodus and Nehemiah, we can see that even using physical force to defend yourself is permissible in some circumstances. However, do this only in circumstances where you're being physically assaulted and have no other choice. Use the amount of force necessary to escape, but don't use it for revenge. Sticking up for yourself may be difficult to do and sometimes seems impossible. But if you're able to stay calm and respond in a loving manner, then you have every right as the image bearer of God to defend yourself and speak the truth. You are worth being defended. And lastly, number four, reach out to those who are being bullied. For those who are being bullied by somebody else, reach out to them. Lastly, we need to reach out to them, and one of the best ways we can do this is to befriend them. Invite them to hang out with us. Not only will this make them feel loved and accepted and less alone than they're currently feeling, but it also acts as a deterrent to the bullying itself. Bullies are much less likely to pick on somebody if they're in a group of friends rather than being alone. Another helpful thing we can do is to comfort them and encourage them. Remind them of the intrinsic worth, that value in combating the lies that bullies speak. Even the little things like spending time with them or giving them a hug can make a bigger difference than we'll ever imagine. Something I heard just the other day I think is so powerful, and it fits perfectly with what we're saying. We so often want to get even with somebody who's bullying us and picking on us. But if we get even with them, we become even with them. We become the people that we are wanting to be against. We become like them. We do things that displeases God, that disappoints God, because our God is a God of love. And we're never going to bring people to Him if we go and do the exact same thing that people are doing to us. getting even with somebody just makes you even with them. So if you're a Christian today, remember that you have the power of the Holy Spirit that lives inside of you. You have the power of God to protect you, to give you wisdom. You were never alone in any situation. If you're not a Christian today, you can walk out of here with this power. Come up and speak to me after this service, and I'll show you how you can follow Jesus and put him into your life. Let us know online so we can walk you through this. So, are you bullying somebody right now? Are you in one of these situations where maybe you're verbally putting somebody down without even thinking about it? This is the time that you repent. Ask for forgiveness. Ask God to open up your heart and understand what you've done, and ask for forgiveness. Remember that Jesus told us, in this life there will be trouble. I mean, so many people feel like, you know, as Christians, in fact, there was a guy I talked to just tonight who said he's a follower of God now, I think a more recent follower of God, and he says ever since that happened, things have been great for him. And I said, that's wonderful, that's awesome, but that's unfortunately not how it works, because there will be trouble. We're in a broken, we're in a fallen world. So sometimes we will have troubles, we will have hardships and heartaches in this world, but Jesus has overcome it, and that's where we have our hope, that having him with us, we can overcome it too. And this isn't a cure for bullying by any means. These words aren't going to stop somebody from bullying you, but hopefully the wisdom that passed down from the God of the universe and the wisdom that's in our Bible can help give you courage as you face this world and help overcome and help those who are being bullied as well. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this message, something that I don't think we talk about enough in churches, but it's such an everyday occurrence, and we're getting ready to start school in so many of our communities in the next week or two. Father, I ask you be with each one of the children that are going to school, whether they're in elementary school or middle school, high school, college. Lord, you know we need it in our adult lives, in our work life, at home sometimes. Father, help us overcome the bullies in our life, in whatever is physical, verbal, or social. Help us not to become like them. Help us not to bully other people. Give us a heart of love. Give us a heart of patience and peace. Give us wisdom above all else and how to treat others so that we can please you and show the light of Jesus to those that we're around. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If I see but don't have love, I waste my breath with every song I bring. An empty voice, a hollow noise. If I speak with a silver tongue, convince a crowd, but don't have love, I leave a bitter taste with every word I say. So let my life be the proof of your. the proof of your love.
Last line, or the title of this song, let my life be the proof of your love. That's what we want. That's our desire as Christians, be the proof of God's love. Just as a reminder, we have Papa Curl's ice cream down here. Hope you get a chance to stop by. It's really, really good ice cream. Next week, we're going to continue on this four-part series. It's not just a teen issue, and we're going to talk about gossip. Now, I know most of you don't ever have to worry about gossip, either doing it yourself or being around it. But just in case you do, it's a great time to hear what God has to say about that. And maybe you have somebody else you'd like to invite that needs to hear this as well. Have a great week. Thanks for coming.